We were getting to our session one of track one. The way you want to look at track one is, like any company, you got to have a soul. For the soul to reside, you need a good body. For body to grow, you need oxygen. Those are the kind of three sessions. What is it that makes a good startup? And what is it that would make it grow? And then grow rapidly. So pretty much the three sessions on track one and track two are analogous. So if your interest is in early stages, the learning lessons would be fairly common. Just the scale is going to be different. Session one, startups are not businesses. Like caterpillars are not butterflies. So obviously our team had been working very creatively to come up with a title for the session. But really speaking, we wouldn't have a better person as one of the domain knowledge experts in this area, but for Dr. Merrick first. He would be the moderator, and we do have a very good panel, which he would take in a minute, he would introduce the panel. And Merrick is currently the director of Flashpoint, which I'm sure you will take time to explain what it is, at Georgia Tech. But if I might take a few things that I know about Merrick. His last name is First, and that's not for a reason, because he actually has many firsts.
Well, I never noticed that before. It's like
Thank you. That was a lame attempt to create some humor in the audience. Anyway, Merrick. Well, Merrick indeed has.
You know that way. You at least should know that my wife's name is April.
All right. Okay. Good. So we've broken some ice here. Merrick truly was one of the first President's Young Investigators Award winners. He also is the first distinguished professor of computer science at Georgia Tech. Clearly, he is something unique in a way because he's been in academia as well as with many startups, seven startups, as co-founder, CEO, played very, very valuable roles in growing those companies. So obviously, we can learn a lot from him and the panel he has been able to put together here. He prior to Georgia Tech, he spent a good time in Berkeley as well as Carnegie Mellon. And over a period of time, when I was sharing some of our thoughts together, he made a very interesting comment, and I find that very profound. He says, even though startups look like black magic and art and many other things, but I think there is a process that goes in making startups successful. And it kind of struck me that yes, entrepreneurs are very passionate, motivated, driven people. They're good people. And good people do make good companies. But if you give good people good processes, they will make a great company. So with that, I would turn it over to Merrick to introduce the panel and take the discussion from here on. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh. You can hear me from here. And I just want to tell you that we have a plan for today. I want to tell you what the plan is. We have maybe a little bit less than an hour. And part of the plan is to make it entertaining. So you can indicate whether it's entertaining by staying and engaging, or you know, there's other ways out. This guy with the camera will move out of your way if you feel the need to have to go. I'm not sure why you might come to this room. It might be that there's no seats out there, I noticed, and it might be that this is the right stage. My guess is it's because you already know the panelists, and so I'm not going to spend a lot of time introducing them. You'll find out more about them as they sort of engage, and you'll get a sense of the authenticity, what they know, and so on. Roughly what I want to do is spend a couple minutes introducing, first I want to answer a question of Suresh's, but then I want to spend a couple minutes introducing them, really short, and then engage with them a little bit in a little bit of a dialogue. There's a microphone right here in the middle, which I think is turned on. I think it was checked. So you don't have to rely on me to generate questions. It'd be great if you had questions and thoughts or assertions you wanted to make that we could knock down mercilessly. So feel free to just move to the middle. If I don't notice you, just wave your hand. I'll probably notice you because you're right there. And then you can engage too. And then after about a little while, whenever that seems to get like long enough, I'll just going to stop, and we're going to do something a little bit different. Quite a few early, really early stage companies tweeted in a contest that we were running before this, saying that they would like to come up and get some direct advice from us, from the panel, from me. And we're going to hold an open office hour. So three really early stage CEOs are going to come up. They're going to we'll make it available for them to sit up here, and then we'll see how that goes. It could be amusing. Let me just quickly run down the panel. Let me tell you the answer to Suresh's question. So Suresh was saying, like, what is it that all early stage companies need? What does a great company need? Do you know the answer to that question? Like, there's actually only one thing a company needs to be successful. It's not money, and it's not a great CEO. They need great customers. That's the answer to that question, which is for all that sounds easy, that's like the hardest part. But let me just run down. So Tal Cohen, so I've known Tal for quite a while. Tal is a serial entrepreneur in Atlanta. He's involved with a company called ClickFox a while ago. Now Tal runs a seed fund that invests here and in Israel. And the thing that's great about Tal for me is that he raised all that money to be able to run the seed fund and is doing the investment. The thing that's frustrating to me is every time I try to find him, he's like on a plane to Israel or coming back. And it turns out I just got invited to go give a talk in Israel, so I just asked him if he'll be there, and just my luck, it sounds like he might not be, to figure it out. So David Cummings, many of you must know, is an incredibly successful, I would say serial entrepreneur, but I actually think that he's a parallel entrepreneur. He's got many companies he's running simultaneously. David will tell us something about them. Phil Hill, I've known Phil now for a few years. For some reason, you hang around the parts of the city that I hang around in, and I appreciate that. Phil, I've also watched Phil work with very early and entrepreneurs, very young, older. Phil had a very interesting ride in the late 90s where he sold the company. It was to Yahoo that you sold it, is that right?
Real Networks.
Real Networks, like Yahoo, but different. But the size of the money was like this somewhere. And then Alan Nance, who many of you may know. Alan is the CEO of one of the largest mailing organizations, email organizations in the world. So with that said, any questions so far? let me tell you, take 2 seconds and tell you about Flashpoint and what we're trying to do at Georgia Tech and what's happened. You know, what does it mean when we might say something like caterpillars, butterflies, what's going on? There are three giant changes that have happened, sort of intellectual changes or ways of thinking about doing a startup. It just everything is different now in the startup world. Let me tell you what they are. The first is a recognition that there is a stage of a startup's life that is completely different than what we used to think that stage was. What people used to do, and probably still do, is they'd go to a startup and they try to make a small version of the business that they're trying to create. And then they don't succeed. Now, that's not true for all businesses, but it's definitely true for businesses which are trying to go either into new markets or for businesses that are trying to resegment an existing market. And it's because you fundamentally don't know who your customers are. So all the things that you normally think about for a business make no sense if you don't know who your customers are. So if you're going into a new startup situation where you actually don't know what your customers are and you don't know why they want something from you and you don't know how to reach them, you're making probably a mistake. I can tell you it's like 1 in 100 chance you get it right if what you do is you try to stand up the thing that you think will work. So the first big insight over the last 5 years or so, the clarity is you shouldn't, as a startup person, try to stand up an initial version of the bigger business. You should do something else. Then the question is, what else do you do? So the second thing that's happened, and I'm calling it startup engineering because we're at Georgia Tech and we have a name for it. Other people are calling it lean startup. And ideas like that, it's the notion there's actually something you should be doing, and it's not the things that you might have been taught as an MBA or not the things that normally make sense relative to a business, because frankly you can't think that way because businesses measure themselves against customers and you don't know who your customers are. So there's another set of processes. Flashpoint is a mechanism at Georgia Tech which we've stood up to do entrepreneurial education of this type. And the third is that we have a better way, we think, or a new way of betting on the earliest stages of businesses. Instead of taking a couple of people trying to figure out what it's worth, how far it can get, and giving them $1 million, $1.5 million to let them run for 1.5 years, better seems to be to bet on a whole bunch of teams simultaneously with a very small amount of money, run them intensely using these kinds of processes for about 3 months, and see how far they get. So far, the evidence is they get really far. So we've run one And just so you'll know, at Georgia Tech, we decided to be the first university in the world that would try to do that, this model. There are existing commercial models. The most famous one is called Y Combinator. There's Techstars, 500 startups. For us to do it as a university, we own the education part of it. Sig Mosley was kind enough to help stand up a fund called the Flashpoint Investment Fund to make risk capital available to the teams that go through this at their discretion to make that available. So we've had one cohort go through. We have quite a few mentors. These folks are not just mentors, they're actually part of the extended teaching team for Flashpoint. And so our job today is to tell you what we're seeing and what we're thinking about this. And I have no idea what they're going to say. I'm curious myself. So, you know, maybe I'll start with Alan, actually. So Alan stood up very early, even before I think Alan must have had any idea what we might be doing, and volunteered. He, like, tracked me down. He hunted me continuously. And I have so many emails from you, and I don't know until just this moment I realized that, like, that's your business, right? You're, like, in the business of getting emails to the right people at the right time. So did you use your whole machine against me?
Yeah.
So anyway, so Alan, what's your impression? And Alan is responsible for helping to organize the external mentor group, and it's like the head mentor in some ways, and we work together. I just love working with you. Thank you so much, Alan. So what are your thoughts about this early stage? Is this making sense to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think what I would say is that I went into it very hesitant, because I'll still say this publicly, and I'll continue to say it. I'm not convinced. I think you can teach entrepreneurship, but I'm not convinced that teaching turn somebody into an entrepreneur. I'm not convinced yet.
So what's an entrepreneur? When you think about an entrepreneur?
When I think of an entrepreneur, I think about somebody who, you know, and I've talked about this a lot. I've always had sort of four definitions of an entrepreneur. The first one is they can see the future, right? The second one is they sort of stand for something. The third one is they can build a team. And the fourth one is, and this is the one that's the hardest, they can formulate capital. Right. I mean, when I think of an entrepreneur, those are kind of the four things that are required. And different people are, you know, suck at different parts of it, and different people are good at different parts. But I think the thing that I have categorically been convinced of is that there is a process that can remove a lot of the risk. And potentially that process could create more entrepreneurs, where without a process, I think you just have to be exceptionally good at all four. And I think maybe with a process, maybe you don't have to be exceptionally good or naturally good at all four. And so early indications from the first cohort and entrepreneurs that I'm meeting with, they're getting a lot further than I got 10 years ago when I started my business, a lot quicker.
You've been working with early-stage companies.
Real quick, I would disagree with Alan on number four. I think
so we'll get to you later then. No, I'm just kidding.
I think formulating capital is more of a historic mindset.
Yeah.
And I think in this day and age, from a number of different trends in the market, you can get so much more done now with no capital. You can do it on the side. I'm not a fan of doing a business on the side, but I think the capital side of it is too much of a focus for most first-time entrepreneurs.
Yeah. So you're saying you don't need any capital?
Well, hold on. Going to say is I don't care if somebody puts $1,000 on their credit card or goes and builds something on the Amazon cloud. They still had to formulate that dollar or that $10. And more importantly, not only did they have to formulate it, they have to allocate it.
So it's actually not dollars you need. I mean, dollars
no,
are
it's
fungible.
Not. I mean, I don't,
you need
no
to pull
one
resources
interpret,
together.
When I say capital formation, no one should interpret that that's a number. It's not $1 million or $2 million or $10. It's just most successful entrepreneurs can organize some amount of money and allocate it to the right things efficiently to get to the place that they're trying to get to.
And I would agree with that statement, but
okay.
So we agree.
Too many entrepreneurs think formulate capital is I need $1 million before I even take my first step. And that's the wrong mindset.
So y'all just learned the first lesson. Don't negotiate with me because you'll lose.
Tal, as somebody who really hopes that entrepreneurs need money because you're standing there with a pot of it, what do you think? You need money? You don't need money?
Well, I think
And then also you speak about the process too. I'm interested in your thoughts.
Well, the let me go back quickly on Flashpoint.
Yeah.
I think that I agree with the fact that the definition of accelerator. It's almost like this equation includes so much feedback, and I would love to have an entrepreneur that goes by Alan's definition, but it doesn't happen. It rarely happens. you always get a spectrum. And you know, people learn. And in the Flash One environment, they learn quickly. And learning quickly is actually, in my opinion, the most important parameter for an entrepreneur.
So what do you think it is about this process? I mean, people have incubators, there are lots of them. There have been people have been trying to learn quickly for a long time. So is there something new that you're seeing or not?
Absolutely. Well, I'm exposed to a variety, you know, in the last probably 15 years, from the old-fashioned type of incubators to, you know, Israel has a two-year entrepreneur incubator, you know, government-sponsored, to the, you know, 3 months level of.
And just as a plug, if you haven't read the book Startup Nation to understand what's happened and transformed in Israel, it's completely crazy. You have to read this book.
So there's a lot of effort, a lot of efforts being done in cultivating, if you will, social type of environment for entrepreneurs with equipment, some money. But there's a level of a sense of urgency that you come up with a 3 months type of, you know, every week, every surrounded with mentors, surrounded with advice, that is really cross fertilizing. In a way that is, you know, immensely important for software.
Let me pull Phil in for a second. So Phil, one of the things that struck me when I very early on met you, I was watching you talk to somebody, or maybe you were explaining to me, and you had this explanation. You had done marketing, I think it was with Coke, and you said, you know, whatever you think you're doing, you have to ask this series of five questions. You have to say why until you actually get to whatever it is that the person actually wants, not what it is that you wanted to sell them. But you're also really involved in this process. I know you've taken this process and. This kind of iterative. So here's what, let me just give you an overview for those of you that might not be familiar with the process. The big idea is basically this: between where you start, where you don't really know very much, and when the company is actually working in the world, what really changes is you can actually, when it's in the world, answer questions like, who are your customers? How do you reach them? What's the value proposition? How much do they pay? How do they evaluate you? What resources did you pull together? What partners do you have? It's an information discovery process to get there, besides the physical part of actually standing it up. And the problem is people walk around with stupid ideas. They're just not true. They think that they're true, but they can't tell the difference. And not stupid because they're stupid, but stupid because as human beings, we're incapable of knowing the difference between what we think should be true about what our customers want and what they actually want. And so this process is this crazy, iterative, intense process of trying to make hypotheses, test the hypotheses, and do that in a way that's like a structured process, almost like you can literally manage this early stage process as opposed to making it random and someplace else. So Phil, what are your thoughts about that?
I don't know. I'm still, maybe you don't want to hear this.
But I do.
I still don't know whether the these startup accelerators actually do anything. My hypothesis, you know, we found these things on a hypothesis.
You can tell I didn't handpick these people.
and I love Flashpoint, and I'm starting my own, you know, one for companies that are the different side of the tracks and don't get access to.
He's called it Flash Issue, and it somehow he doesn't realize that.
No, founder machines. Yeah. But anyway, to answer your question, I'm not sure. So I'm in the throes of, it's very interesting. I started the business in January, and I gave myself a budget of $2,500 to launch a business. And I just launched my first minimum viable product yesterday, and it's at $8,400. You know, $8,000 I've spent so far. Now, would have I done that regardless of whether I'd be in Flashpoint? Will have all of those companies who are in Flashpoint worked it out themselves if they're good entrepreneurs? I think you're either a good entrepreneur or you're not. I think the one thing it gives you is it cures the loneliness thing, and it gives you a sounding board for it's socialization. And for me, you could be doing it. You could put everyone in there and you could talk about, you know, basketball or whatever. Entrepreneurs will end up socializing around their business, and they will just talk to each other, they'll ask questions. That's the process that I think is important. So
I should make a list, just so you know, that there may be, I ask people a lot what they're seeing in the process like this, or whether it's possible that we've really identified an initial phase, whether or not there are things we really ought to do in an order, whether there are tests you could actually do and learn amongst each other. And what's very interesting to me about this time, it's like I'm looking at it and I'm thinking the whole world is different. So I'm looking at Y Combinator. They found, after 5 years, they stood up 300 companies. They made a $5 million total investment across the whole thing. And the net, the value of those companies was $4.7 billion. That's 1,000x. And I'm comparing that in my head to, okay, here's what I thought before. One in 100 company has any chance to get anywhere. So 300 gets to 1,000x with $5 million invested. versus. So, and the numbers are seem to be true for all these accelerators. So now a natural question is, okay, why? What is it that people are bringing?
No, it's harder to get into Y Combinator than it is to get into Harvard. I mean, they're good entrepreneurs going in there. So if you let them loose,
I completely agree with you. What I'm saying is what's interesting to me, and the reason I wanted to organize this panel, is I don't think we know the answer. I don't think we know whether it's process, whether it's the fact that it's 3 months, whether it's small money, whether it's great entrepreneurs, whether it's a Lonely Hearts Club. I don't think we know, but I think you can't afford not to find out. I think you can't afford, if you're an entrepreneur or working with entrepreneurs or investing in entrepreneurs, you can't afford not to see that there's enormous change, and we need to figure out why. And everybody's looking at it, and they make up their own stories in their own head about why. I like your story. I like other stories, too. But what do you think?
I would add this. How many people in the room either have a startup now or have a startup idea? How many people in the room? How many people?
I guess we came to the right
place. Okay, here's the question. How many people in the room will fail with that startup? You're dead wrong. Everybody in the room will fail.
This is so here's the point.
Here's the point of that exercise. The thing that a process can do is allow you to fail quickly.
Get out.
Right? No.
Safely
maybe pivot,
quickly.
Maybe change, but my point is that the worst thing that can happen to an entrepreneur, the very worst thing, is to not fail quickly, to fail a year and a half, 2 years into your idea, your product not being viable. And I think the one thing that I am convinced of now is that a process, I agree with Phil, I'm not convinced it can make an entrepreneur. But one thing I think the process can do, or all of you should be thinking about, hell, I think about it every day, is what people, what process, what tools do I need to fail as quickly as humanly possible, so that I can get to the thing that will be successful.
I love that way of saying it. While I turn it over to the next folks, anyone have a question? Just jump up to the microphone.
So another item.
Oh, yeah, David, go ahead.
I agree with Phil that the socialization, the Lonely Hearts Club, is a really important part of the accelerator. I also think that it's very important to be a speed dating club for mentors as well as potential investors.
Yes.
Because if you go out on your own and you go try to meet 50 people in the community that could possibly be a mentor and another 50 that could possibly be an investor, you can spend an inordinate amount of time and have little results. So I think there's a huge value add.
And we see that.
It's a much more efficient process.
You get the serendipity of it, and then people are sharing knowledge across it. So let's go ahead.
Maybe say
what your name is, and if you have a company you want to plug, go ahead.
My name is Isabel, and I'm actually a student at Georgia Tech. My question is, a lot of us have more than one idea, and how do you choose which one to invest in and like fail at?
I've got a real simple answer for that one.
Go ahead, Phil.
Do not start a business unless it's not fixing a problem you personally have. So that will probably get through a lot of those ideas. For most people, it does. I've learned the hard way. Whenever I've tried to start a business and it's not fixing my problem, it's tough. So
someone else must have another view of that.
Yeah.
Go ahead, David, and then
never do more than one idea at once.
Uh-huh. Said David, who's doing many ideas. Okay. So, until you get good at it.
Tal?
I mean, you take the ideas and examine what idea has the most sense of urgency in solving that idea to someone. Okay. If you have problem finding this idea is going to have, it's going to be difficult to apply if solving a problem to someone, just throw it away quickly.
Okay, great. Any other, please. Cindy, rush up there and use the mic because I think they're recording it.
All right, well.
Okay, well, thank you, Cindy.
Should I use my good side? No,
yes.
Anyway, I guess, I think it was you, David, that said never do one idea at once. The business that we're in, which is the business of entertainment, is moving so quickly here in, specifically in the Southeast, just because of the tax breaks and so on and so forth. And we have a combination of two things. We have a instructional dance studio, but we also have one of the more successful talent agencies that provides talent for film, commercial, etc. And so, in thinking about...
You're scarred.
Yeah, we 15 yeah. seconds on what you are. Now, what's the question?
Okay, and thinking about what, you know, which idea is going to work, but with the industry moving so quickly, there's so many things that we can do and we don't want to miss out. How would you recommend that we handle that?
Good. One quick answer, and then we're going to shift to another mode. Go ahead.
I mean, I would just say this. I mean, I think that there are untold numbers of opportunities out there. I mean, you could come up with probably 10 more. I just always encourage people to pursue things that they're really passionate about. If you feel like your life calling is to get me on a commercial, which I'd be completely comfortable with that, if you feel like that's your life calling, if you really love the dance thing, I just personally, it's a singular answer from my point of view, I just choose to do things that I'm passionate about. Doesn't mean every other people are passionate about it, but it's really freaking hard, and it's a lot easier if you're working on something that you're passionate about.
I would add something else. I would think, take a decision, because the one thing is going to hurt each other. So take a decision.
You're right.
The two things that, let me just summarize, because I spend a lot of time talking to folks that are running these kinds of facilities and figuring this out. Here's what seems to work. Pick one and do it. What doesn't seem to work is try to evaluate 15. That doesn't seem to work. You can evaluate 15, do them serially. Just go crazy deep on one, see how it goes. And the question of which one do you go on, the mistake is to optimize. Satisfy. Pick some criteria which are good enough, big enough addressable market, you have access to talent, you're passionate about it. Pick some criteria and just pick one, go deep on it. That works better than trying to figure out among all your ideas which is the best one. There is no best one, you can't know now anyway. So with that said, what I want to do is I want to switch gears, if you're okay with that. If you're not okay, there are more of you than there are of me, but I have the power of the microphone so you can change my plan. But my plan now is to bring up to the stage, in order, three founders who have said that they have a burning question or more. And the opportunity for them, the first one is Pete. Is Pete here? Oh, Pete's right there. Okay, let me get him a chair. Let me do this.
You can stand here. You're healthy there.
Can you hear me? We have this all worked out. Come with me. There was a conversation beforehand whether or not we should put them down below or up above or like video it in. Is this mic working?
Okay. Yep.
But we thought this would be nice. So actually, if you wouldn't mind, your conversation is with them. They're just here to kibitz and see and feel your pain. So what I've asked the entrepreneurs to do is to just take a moment to tell us what their business is. So, you know, I guess in return for being up here, they get to tell you what their business is. But I've also asked them to ask one real question. So imagine that you're the founder of a company, it sounds like many of you are, and there's one thing that's happening in your world, and you just don't know what to do. I don't know what they're going to ask, I don't know what these guys are going to say or what I'm going to say, but we'll see.
Good morning.
Good morning, Pete.
I'm Pete Santora, and my company is Thunder Lizard. Thunder Lizard is, we create digital personas around channel content and influence using social data. And we have looked at a number of different customer segments from retailers to B2B clients to what I call event-driven platforms, but email marketing services, marketing automation services, platforms that...
So I want to say, get to the question because that's where the value is going to be. And I want to try to get three folks in.
Great. Good. Founding partner. This is my second software company. My first one, I knew the founding partner very well. That was great. This company, I don't know the founding partners out in the community developing that. Give me some insights on specifically a tech person, but partnering, getting a co-founder with you, what you look at and how you kind of negotiate that.
Great question.
I've got a story around, so I was looking for a technical co-founder. I found one. It was the most bizarre story. I had put an ad out for $90 on a website and actually got, it was like I felt like I was kind of a guy who couldn't find a date, but it was, but I got back a really, really good candidate. He ended up being my co-founder, and he is a killer guy. I mean, he's great. So it's, I don't think there's any easy way. I think you've got to get out there and just network and try everything, and no one's going
to
give.
Were there other people who responded that you said no to that you could introduce them to?
Yeah, there was some nightmares.
You could save them $90. Oh, not those guys.
Yeah, it was findacofounder.com I went to. So yeah.
Was, really?
Yeah, really. Yeah, wow. It really was. Wow. That's sad, isn't it?
It's
worth a bet.
It's like CF date or something. David, yeah.
Two quick thoughts. One is you do have to kiss a lot of frogs to find a prince or princess. And the second one is I do think a co-founder is critical. I think too often entrepreneurs go off as the lone ranger, and it's extremely difficult to be successful doing that.
Yeah.
So here's the difficulty. I mean, if you look for a technical co-founder, I assume that it's not easy for you to evaluate them from a technical perspective. So there's a challenge for you. Another thing, the one thing you can evaluate them is on the chemistry level among two of you. So, I mean, I would start, I mean, I don't know how you started. You can start, but in your first startup, but I would start in a kind of consulting engagement with maybe one or two, a few or something. And for that, you have to pay something, unfortunately. But since it's the most sensitive marriage you can have in a startup, I would really start to be, you know, take it on a slow ride and see how you get along.
Yeah, it's all, sorry, yeah, you, no, no, you have
no,
your
no.
go.
No, no, I was just gonna, the only thing I was gonna add is that people who are entrepreneurs, and I think you fancy yourself one, people who are entrepreneurs view that as their job. And all I would say is like my example, I mean, I'm running a company now, but I just invested in a startup, and it was somebody that I had met 10 years ago. It's something that I do all the time. Does that mean it's not like, okay, I'm starting a business, now let me go, you know, stand for something. Now let me go formulate capital.
There was something in what he asked that made it sound like he was or wasn't an entrepreneur.
Look back. I would just challenge you to look back over the last 5, 6, 7 years of everyone that you've met, the people that you've interacted with. They might not be a technical co-founder, but they might know one. And that's where I always start. I mean, I just start with the relationships that I already have, and I would just encourage you to do that.
Really good advice. Pete, have you been trying to find a technical co-founder for a while?
Yes.
So what have you been doing or not doing that you think is impinging upon your ability to do that, get a technical co-founder? And actually, I'm going to leave with this thought because I want to get other people up here. I just point out to you that there's something that's causing you to not get a technical co-founder. It's almost surely a set of things that you're doing or not doing. You can't change those unless you know why you're doing them or not doing them.
Well, you've got to decide what you want as well. I mean, is a technical co-founder someone you're going to pay $250,000 a year from day one? And you'll find co-founders for that. I'm being kind of flippant, but I assume it's like, what exactly do you want? I wanted someone who wanted I wanted them in just to work for equity. Not because I didn't want to pay them. I can pay them, but
not because I really don't want to hear, and because I know Pete wants to hear. Let's thank Pete and bring up next founder. There's a terrific question. As you're going, Avi will be next. You want to right here. So as you're stepping down, let me just and grab this microphone. Let me just say that that question is top five questions that I get all the time. For example, these accelerators at Flashpoint, here's something we seem to know. It requires at least two people. The amount of work you have to do for this initial period of time is it requires at least two people. I've been looking at one person here who's a single founder there, and I think he's probably smiling because the answer is probably that's right. And then a lot of people show up with like an idea or an opportunity they think, but they don't have the skill sets themselves to actually make progress, and so people are looking for these co-founders. So one of the difficulties you're also facing is it's a thin market, and what you'll mostly hear is random stories about how it worked out for them, not uniform stories. But don't give up.
And you can always learn how to code yourself.
Code
Academy.
And, you know, for better or worse, I'll just give you this my straight opinion about it. Where did you go? My straight opinion. No, right there. Your story is too complicated. I was listening really hard. I'm in the space. I have no idea what you do. If you're trying to get a technical co-founder, shorten it by like 40 words.
Bobby.
All right, thanks. Hello, Temporary Advisors. This is great. It's like a startup, you know, reality TV show.
Say your name.
My name is Abhi Sharma, Fourth Wall Technologies. This is our company. We started in October. We've already pivoted once. We're basically mobile gaming, and we're trying to attach instant gratification with real merchants' rewards in a nearby area, incremental consumer behavior. So my question, it revolves around money. Just a little background on our team. There's three of us, two engineers and a design guy, two of them in Orlando, me here in Atlanta. And one of the questions, we're ready to kind of take the deep dive. We hate to hear this, but I'm working on it part-time. So there's three of us working on it part-time. So my question to you is, we're looking for runway capital. What's the best way to approach investors? What time frame? You know, we talk about 6-month runway, 1-year runway. We talk about different amounts of capital that we need. We know technology, we can, you know, iterate fast. What are your guys' thoughts on that?
Why don't we start with Tal, since he has capital.
Hey,
Tal.
obviously, you know, you need to show something. Okay, so first of all, everybody part-time is okay, but not good. Your description of the domain is interesting, but what's the meat there? So, and today you see so many startups that are you can compare yourself to. So you really need to be better. You need to understand how to have a winning pitch. So winning facts, like, you know, some curve that grows of users, or some connectivity to business model, something that's gonna attract somebody to invest money in you. Why should we choose you? Okay, quickly.
Other thoughts?
So the number one funder of startups is actually based in Richmond, Virginia. Can anybody guess who it is?
Visa.
Capital One. Capital One has the most aggressive credit card rates, and that is the primary source of startup funding in the United States.
Yeah, why do you need money? What do you want it for?
Some of our team members, one of them's getting married, just circumstances. Marriage. Yeah, sorry.
Does his wife work?
His wife does work, yeah.
There you go.
For salary, yeah?
A little bit, yes.
Yeah.
I would just go back, I know I sound like a broken record, I would just go back to this, which is, you know, as an example, my personal opinion is that people who are successfully raising money today started a really long time ago, right? Like the relationship started, you know, I don't need any money, but I'm constantly developing those bridges of people who could potentially fund some business that I don't even know what the hell it is right now, right? 2 years from now. So I would just encourage you that it's a process and it's ongoing and it never stops and you just have to continue going. But the second thing I would say is what I see is appetites from early stage investors to fund salaries is pretty low. And I'm not trying to rain on your parade. I'm just trying to be honest with you. It doesn't mean it's not possible. It just means that there is a very, very low appetite for it. Most funders today want to fund something going to market, right? It's gotten to where they don't want to fund salaries. It's damn near to the point where they don't want to fund development,
I mean,
right? That'll be the next
thing. It's unbelievably good advice you're hearing. Let me summarize it a little bit. They don't want to fund your ability to work on it necessarily, certainly the way you've described it. And it's people make these decisions enormously much on relationship. And part of the reason is there's nothing else. But what else? They're looking at you. You don't have customers. You don't have anything happening. I mean, unless you get to a place like Tal was describing, where you have customers and revenue growth, or you have customer growth and you have something obvious, they're basically funding you as a person. It's very hard to get people to fund you as a person unless they have a relationship with you, and that's not like an overnight thing. So let me ask you, I want to ask him a question. Like, why do you think someone should write you a check?
Yeah, that's a good question. We're figuring that out. We've built products before, so we built the product, we actually sold it, we made some revenue. But then listening to our customer feedback, we actually pivoted. So now we're going to the next stage.
There's only one answer to that. I'm going to make you more money than you're giving me. And I mean, and unless you they're investing, they're not
a
charity.
So Tal had some thoughts. Go ahead.
I mean, it's also, let's say the position is so different. For example, if you, let's say you're a third time entrepreneur, you sold your 2-3 companies and you have a relationship, you're going to get money if you need it. You make money for people before, a lot of it's going to be easy. You're going to do it the first time, you got to really prove it. To yourself, to your co-founders, first and foremost, that you can do that. So, I mean, don't expect people to write you checks before you are willing to commit something.
Let me just give you some direct advice, and then we can. I think we should go on to the next entrepreneur. What's happening in the mind of the investor is they're trying to figure out what you need the money for. The money, you're going to use the money. The money is gas for you to get somewhere. If it's gas for you to, like, work for another 3 months on something that you want to work on for another 3 months, that's a really hard sell unless it's your parents or your uncles or your wife. You need to give, in your own head, you need to understand why is it that you're taking money from someone. What is it you're going to do with their money that they wouldn't be able to do if they didn't put the money in your hands to work with? So until you get clarity about that and what you're going to get to, you can't. It's very difficult to raise money. But that's the place to start. Okay, so next, let me grab this mic. In case it wasn't clear, Avi's raising money. So for those of you in the room who didn't raise your hand because you're entrepreneurs, you're investors.
Hey, Merritt, if I could just add one thing. The only thing I would add is this, and I cannot say it enough times. If you're an entrepreneur, you are always raising money. You're not always taking money. There's a difference, right? But you are always I meet with people that I've never raised any money for, but I'm still meeting with them. I'm still telling them what I'm working on, still telling them what I'm seeing in the market. I'm still developing relationships all the freaking time.
Ellen's like a new acronym, ABR, always be raising.
Yeah. But does not mean that you're taking money from everyone. It just means it's a process.
Any other summary thoughts? Adam Getty. Let me introduce you to Adam Getty. So I got to know Adam. Weird ways. Actually, I think Sig first told me I should talk to Adam a while ago, and I tried to find him. I think he was operating businesses in countries whose names I'm not sure of. Adam is, I present to you Adam, he went through Flashpoint, so he may also be able to offer some thoughts about what Flashpoint is like. Adam, I'll let you say something about yourself and the company in question.
Sure. No, thank you all very much for the opportunity. And I know some of the people on this panel, and I sincerely appreciate your time, and it's a pleasure to meet some folks I haven't yet to meet. My name's Adam Getty. I did go through the Flashpoint program. I'm currently the founder of a company called Social Fortress. We are in the data privacy and data control space, bringing one simple thought to mind. That is actually putting the creator of the data in control of their privacy and their data, right? So that's what we do. We do it for consumers and enterprises. My question, and I thought a lot about this, and going through Flashpoint, which I will say was invaluable as a repeat entrepreneur, it really helped that iterative process. It helped the socialization side of it, bouncing ideas off. I made some great friends in the program that have been immensely beneficial to us. And my question is a little follow-up on to the previous gentleman. I raised a round of capital recently, and actually I want to preface this one second. The process at Flashpoint, one thing I did not feel a lot of companies did that I think will be very valuable. A lot of people are very shy and afraid to put themselves out because they're afraid of hearing no or afraid of hearing things they don't want to hear. I have come to firmly believe you need to get advice that you can use, not advice that you want to hear. And so I'm asking this question because it's advice I need. And it may be unorthodox to ask the question here. So I raised a round of capital recently in the seven figures. Phil actually participated in that, in full disclosure.
Thanks for telling everyone.
And so we had an unorthodox structure to our round. So if anybody ever says there's one way to go raise money, they're lying. There are n number of ways to do every aspect of
business. What's your question?
That's nice. Yeah. So we had one closing, and we're having a second closing, right? We've got a lot of great people interested in participating in that closing. And as the founder of the company, I've talked to a lot of the people that could put money into this round, right? And I've come down to what I feel is best for the company, where we are now, where we want to go, with the people I think should participate. How do you manage when others who have already participated are uncomfortable with the new investors because they don't know them well, because they're not part of a local group? And how would you manage to get past that? What would you recommend?
That's a fantastic question.
I think it depends. There's probably a pecking order of the people who are invested in there. Certain people put a small amount in, certain people put a lot more in. So
whether you feel you've got an obligation. The guys who put a little in, tough. I'm sorry. You put a little in, that's just what you do. But the guys have put in more in, and maybe you want to cultivate them for later, then...
No, I'm just... This is not like they're uncomfortable because they're, like, part of the mafia in New York or something. This is, like...
No, Zay's a very, very well-respected firm. Mm-hmm. And one member of a group of investors is uncomfortable because they just don't know the moment. And my fear...
But I think if this is the excuse, not done well enough, I think it's fine. I mean, mm-hmm. Look, I mean, investors, that's good. I mean, you want to have investors that are coming from different perspective. You know, it's an opportunity for them to meet and invest together. Maybe it's going to be only one, the first engagement they have together.
Unless it's a euphemism for they don't like the person or
yes.
They don't like
so, I mean,
the
but
reputation.
I don't think Adam has a problem with euphemism, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. Don't know him seems fine.
Yeah, I mean.
Just push forward. Do what you want to do.
Yeah, go for it.
I mean, you know my position, right? I mean, we're in an open forum. I can't start cussing, but they... I mean, my whole thing is just this, is that if you're
the CEO
and founder of the company, I mean, I've always told people, that I've had crosses with investors all the time, and I'm like, I'm in charge of this business. I need to guide it in the direction that I feel like is going to ultimately get us to the point that in the future that I feel like I see. And I'm going to do what I have to do until such time as everybody thinks they have a better alternative. And then that's just simply not going to be me. Right. So, I mean, you have to build consensus to a point, but it's not, I mean, I tell people this all the time, leading an entrepreneurial startup is not a democracy. It's just not, you know, because it's just not going to get you where you need to go. So you have to decide if you think it's the right thing to do. And if you do, you got to be able to say why and defend it.
Yeah, it's dead on right. So what everybody who wrote the check to you in the first place is assuming that you, Adam Getty, are going to somehow use their money effectively, that they're betting on you. So now you've come to a place where something has to be decided and they may disagree with you. If you can get as much information as you can about why they disagree with you, and you can process that, and then you make your decision, then you're doing actually what they asked you to do when they made the first investment. And you simply need to feel good about that because you can't do better than that.
So I would just summarize this. No entrepreneur, including you, Adam, should get caught up in you constantly defending why your future is true or why you think you need to do something. Sometimes when I get advice from somebody, I make them defend why that's right. Right? It goes both ways. It's not just people lambasting you with questions and you constantly have to defend it. It goes the other way. If somebody thinks this is a bad idea, fine. I'll take your advice. Tell me why you think it's a bad idea and defend it. And there's just not enough people do that.
So so the annoying thing about this question, which is an incredibly real question, is the advice you got back was decide. You know, you get to decide. I'll summarize the advice, that there's nothing obvious about this one way or the other, except that, yes, there's conflict. You have stakeholder conflict. You should know going into it, one of the things you should factor in is if you make this decision and these guys show up and then it doesn't work out for some reason. It's hard to imagine exactly how it doesn't work out. I mean, investors, once the money is in, there's not that much they do unless you're putting them on a board or you're giving them some voting control, in which case you just know that then one headache you're going to have to manage is relationship between those two. So I would say in your head, can you figure out how to manage that? If not, it's probably not worth the money. That's another consideration.
Yeah, don't
how
bring
much money
an investor on you're not comfortable with, because
yes,
it will make your life a misery.
Or if the situation between them is uncomfortable. So that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
if they just don't know each other, I don't see any problem with that.
You have any other questions?
Sure,
yeah. Let me just give you an opportunity. No, do you have one more? I want to give you the chance. I'm going to ask everybody else also. But if you have one more question in addition, that was such a great question. I'll give you a second shot. Are there, that's right.
Maybe some questions from the audience.
I guess it's like friends of Flashpoint. Yeah. Maybe the audience has some questions. Yeah. You want to come up? So then let's thank Adam. And that was, of all the questions, that was a real question. I really thank you for exposing that. Great.
Hi, my name is Suhail. I have a question for the audience before I start my question. Everybody here is an entrepreneur. How many people think they're also innovators? All right, the number's pretty high, not as high as I was expecting, but my question is about trust. As an innovator who is also an entrepreneur, and perhaps as an innovator who is not a very good entrepreneur, how do you protect yourself? How do you protect the idea before you present it to others, short of patenting it?
I have the answer to this. What you do is you buy a billboard right in front of the company that you're most afraid of, and you spell out in big animal pictures, letters, exactly what it was that you are afraid that they'll steal from you. Then you wait a while, and you'll discover that nothing happens. and if you're worried about doing it with your best idea, take your second best idea and do that. Nothing will happen. People do not want to get rich on your idea. They want to get rich on their own idea. So you're worried about something that's not real.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
Just do it.
Just do it. No issues at all. Tell everyone what it is to the nth degree. And
the benefits of telling is way outweigh the...
No, I mean, if there are IP issues, talk to an attorney before you do that. We're not attorneys.
All right. Actually, the question is a little bit more deeper also. Within your own team, as you get people to work together, as the idea kind of develops, how do you, in your experience, I would like to know some, real examples. How do you formulate a strategy so that, the ownership of the idea, and also protecting yourself against outsiders, but also, within your own team, the team that you have set together, how do you put that?
Go ahead.
I don't understand the question. You want protection from your own team?
I think he means it's not a business yet. They're just formulating.
They're just forming the idea, right?
I got a real life example for you.
Thank you.
With the startup that I'm working on right now, we started at Waffle House, right? And literally, I just wanted to do another business, so I started meeting David and I met. I started meeting with everyone I'd met with over the last 10 years, and there were 5 people that were involved. And somebody asked me that at breakfast, and I swear to God, this was my answer. We'll develop an idea. Y'all go do it, but I'm not going to be involved, and let's see what happens, right? So my point is that you cannot be fixated on that. You cannot be fixated on that because people aren't attracted to it, right? When it starts with how we're going to divide ourselves up, people want to be part of a team that's inclusive and where there's 1 or 2 or 3 people that they really feel like are going somewhere. So I would just encourage you. I mean, that's what I did. Somebody asked that exact question, and I was like, it's a non-question. Because I'm not being involved in something like that.
It's an incredibly useful answer for me. I hope it's useful for you. We have time for one more. One more if it's quick. Yes, please. So say who you are, what your question is.
Eric Langley. I have a startup called Abeo. It's a social network for personal and organizational development. Cool. I have a question regarding what I consider to be a paradox, and that is being steadfast versus pivoting. When you look at what Amazon has done with Jeff, the market would say, why are you putting all this money into this? Mm-hmm. But persevering over a long period of time versus...
Let's hear what they have to say. I have something to say, then we'll wrap. Okay, go ahead. Great question. It's a central question.
For me, it's the hardest one out there because to be an entrepreneur and succeed, you've got to be persistent. But you meet so many people who are doing an idea for 4 years and you're like, give up. So I don't know. If I'm still talking to customers and customers are still, I always go back to the customer. If I still hear them asking for it and they're telling me they want it, then I'm a happy bunny. And that. I do not jump into the product and then start telling myself I'm building a great product, this is a great feature, I need it. I'll go the other way, I'll go customer centric, and that's always the way I've always dealt with that. That helps me sleep.
That's a great point, that most entrepreneurs fail in that they are in love with their product more so than they're in love with their customers.
Well, I think that, Eric, I think that sometimes the problems can be that way, but sometimes even a little success is dangerous. So if you have user adaptation, you see the curve goes, but it's not, the question is what other opportunity you lose. So it's always good to a little bit venture and measure the opportunity somewhere else, particularly in the early stage. And don't get caught up if you have a little success, it might be a really big success somewhere else, order of magnitude. So
and keep trying.
I mean, I would just summarize this, and I'm not picking on everybody in the room because it's always the exact same percentage. 90% of the people always raise their hand and say they're an entrepreneur, and then 2% of the people raise their hand and say they're going to fail, right? Because there's this psychological barrier that you have that failure is somehow not, like, I'm trying to fail every day, like, as fast as I possibly can. So I think the worst thing...
You're not succeeding.
I mean, I'm being serious. It's like you suck if you fail, right? And I just think culturally it's a problem, and it's something that I work on still to this day. But I think the thing that I would encourage you to do is just this, which is just to figure out a way that you can fail as fast as possible in a big, I'm not talking like a cataclysmic failure.
I think that's, let me just tell you a perspective that I have on this, and it's this. In order to be a successful entrepreneur, you have to change the world. So you have to be the kind of person who can effectuate change. You have to be proactive. That kind of a person just does stuff. At the same time, here's the real problem. The mistake you make, you're doing stuff and you don't know that it has a chance of working. You only think it has a chance of working because it's in your head. You have to say, what am I assuming that I don't realize I'm assuming that I'm bullshitting myself is true, and test that instead of doing it. That's the mistake. That's the classic mistake. I'm going to build this, the customers are going to be there, and they'll only know about it. I can only know that by building it. That's not true. What I can tell you is if you build it, there's like 1 in 100 chance they'll be there. And that those odds are too expensive. Okay, so I'm going to have to stop. How was this for you? Format was good? So these guys are like rock stars. For me, it's great. I got a chance to work with them in real life as well as here. So thank you very much, guys. And thank you all for the questions. Thank you for to our three entrepreneurs for exposing themselves in a reasonable way in public. And Suresh, do you have something to say? Yes.
Very important announcement. Please grab your lunch and go to the ballroom. Mm-hmm.